Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's webcast, Hacking Back, Proactive Threat Intelligence with Honeypots for Active Defense. I'm Kate Carson, Marketing Coordinator here at Tripwire, and I'm very excited to be part of today's webcast. Before we start, I'd like to go over a couple of housekeeping items. First of all, make sure that your audio is streaming correctly. Please note that the audio portion will stream through your PC or laptop speakers, and be sure to check that your speaker volume, the volume settings in Windows or Mac OS, or your headset to ensure that it's turned on and volume is at an audible level. Today's webcast is presented using a slide deck, so you can click on the expand rectangle on the top corner of the slide area to enlarge. Now, if you're not seeing the slide movement in your console, you can try hitting the refresh icon in your browser URL bar or hitting the F5 to refresh. If you happen to have technical difficulty, please click on the help widget. It has a question mark icon and covers common technical issues. And if you have a question for our presenters, you can click on the Q&A widget at the bottom and submit your question. We're going to set aside about 10 minutes at the end for Q&A at the end of the presentation. And lastly, I will be sending out a link to the on-demand version of this webcast and a link to the slides. So now let's get on with the presentation. Today our speakers are Ioannis Koniaris and Ken Weston. Ioannis Koniaris is an information security engineer and researcher. His interests include honeypots, honey clients, botnet tracking, malware analysis, intrusion detection, and security visualization. His full bio can be found in the speaker bio widget at the bottom of your screen. Ken Weston is a security researcher here at Tripwire, whose technology exploits and endeavors have been featured in Forbes, Good Morning America, Dateline, New York Times, and The Economist. His full bio also can be found in the speaker bio widget at the bottom of your screen. So now, without further delay, I will hand it over to Ken Weston. Take it away, Ken.
Oh, thank you, Kate, and welcome everyone to our webcast. I'm really excited about this webcast and our guest. I actually saw Ioannis present at B-Sides Las Vegas last month. I was particularly fascinated by his work with HoneyDrive and asked if he would come on the webcast here with us to teach folks about his work and honeypots in general. But before we have Ioannis present and go into a detailed description of honeypot tools and methods, I thought I'd provide a sort of a high-level overview of where honeypots fit in an overall enterprise defense strategy as well as in threat intelligence. So in thinking where honeypots fit into our defense strategy, I kept coming back to this quote from Sun Tzu from The Art of War about knowing our enemies and knowing ourselves, which I find correlates rather well to the ongoing game of vulnerabilities and threats we deal with when defending our network. So on the vulnerability-centric side of defense, we have strong focus on prevention. We identify vulnerabilities and patch them before adversaries can exploit them, with really heavy reliance on signature-based detection. We also hopefully know a great deal about our IT assets and data, which we entrust or are entrusted to protect. However, although we know a lot about what we're protecting, we don't know a lot about the threats that are targeting us. The vulnerability-centric model focuses on all threats equally without context and raises challenges when new or previously unknown threats are at play. So when we combine the vulnerability-centric approach with a threat-centric approach, we add another perspective to the mix that understands that eventually prevention will fail. That is simply the nature of the world we live in. Particularly with honeypots, we are also able to bring in data collection and observation to make our defenses stronger. We gain better insight into our adversaries' tools, tactics, and procedures, and are able to bring in data from a wide range of sources, allowing us to broaden our detection capabilities to more than just signatures alone. So different threat actors, they have different goals and objectives in mind, as well as different level of resources and, of course, patience. Knowing who is targeting us and the tools they're using provide us with a rich insight that bolsters our defenses. So an APT, they're usually going to be targeting us for intellectual property. A bot is after our computing resources. A script kiddie simply might be trying to play and probe and maybe do site defacement. Hacktivists may be trying to cause damage to our systems. And then, of course, criminal syndicates, like we've seen with Target and other retailers, where they're actually after financial gain, targeting credit cards and other information. So another quick quote from another historical strategic thinker, Napoleon here. In addition to gathering intelligence about our attackers, it provides us with an important benefit. We're able to slow the attacker down by simply wasting their time, as well as through bolstering our own defenses. The overall message of the 2014 Verizon DBI report, which provides key annual metrics around data breaches, can be summed up in this graphic, which maps the time it has taken for an attacker to compromise an asset versus the time it takes for a defender to discover the breach over the past 10 years. The gap is widening. By slowing attackers down and gathering data about their activities, we can minimize this gap, decreasing the time it takes for us to respond and increase the time it takes them to actually compromise our networks. So with that, I would like to hand the presentation over to Ioannis, and who will be providing a more in-depth look at honeypot tools and how you can leverage them in your environment. Ioannis?
Thank you, Jen, and hello to all of our viewers. And let me start by thanking Tripwire, and especially Jen, for this invitation. I would start by giving a small introduction about me. I started using honeypots for my thesis, actually, some years ago, and then I continue on with some academic work around the subject, and I published some papers. After that, my interest got a bit, my interest got bigger and bigger in this field, and I joined a non-profit organization called the HiNet Project, which is comprised of researchers that would do work around honeypots. And I also have my own personal website where I publish some open source project, and I have been maintaining that for the last 3 years. And some of the tools I have created that you might have used include HoneyDrive, which is a bundle Linux distribution with many honeypots tools, Kipograph or HoneyDBs, which are some visualization tools, and some other scripts and contributions to other projects. And I'm also very much interested in collaboration for new tools and research if somebody wants to contact me after the webinar. So let me start by giving some definitions and do a quick introduction of honeypots. A formal, let's say, definition can be found in the first bullet, which comes from Lance Pitzner, who is a well-known researcher in the field of honeypots, and he says that the honeypot is an information system resource whose value lies in authorized or released use of that resource. So we're basically talking about a system with no production value whatsoever, and there is also no legitimate reason for any user to either use it or interact in any way with it. Furthermore, any communication attempt that happens with the honeypot and another resource is automatically can be considered malicious, and also a honeypot that we have in our network that tries to connect to another system outside of our network or another system inside our network is probably already compromised by some adversary. Honeypots are both deceptive tools and traps. They lure attackers to attack them, but they also make them waste their time and effort while in turn we are monitoring their actions and learning more about how they operate. Honeypots, of course, cannot prevent attacks against our networks by themselves, but they can help very much in the detection phase of an attack and also identify the methods that the attackers are using to exploit our systems, and the recommendation is to use them with firewalls and IDS systems, because honeypots basically can patch, let's say, the weaknesses of firewalls and IDS systems, and so we can have a more complete protection of our networks. So honeypots basically emulate two kind of things: operating systems and services themselves. The operating system emulation is usually done using the so-called fingerprints. So the TCP/IP stack has some parameters, 8 if we want to be precise, that are not fixed, and it's up to the hands of an operating system's developers to implement them and choose what values they think that are best for the operating system they are creating. So this set of values creates a 67-bit signature, and it's the same way that other tools are also using that in order to identify remote operating systems, like for example Nmap. And the service emulation is being done by using specific scripts that mimic the behavior of the real services. So we can classify honeypots into different categories based on two different criteria. The first one is the purpose of the honeypot deployment, and the second one is the level of around interaction between the honeypot and the attacker. So based on the first criteria, which is the purpose of our honeypot deployment, we have production honeypots and research honeypots. Production honeypots are generally placed alongside the real systems of our business, and they act as decoys. Ideally, we set them up so they are mirrors of the real servers we have in our DMZ, for example, so attackers can waste their time and effort on those while we're gathering intelligence and information, and also perhaps their tools or specific exploits that they are using against our systems. And the second category, research honeypots, are mostly deployed to monitor attacking activities and capture traffic, tools, and generally enhance our knowledge of how attackers operate. And they are generally deployed by, let's say, non-profit organizations or government agencies and these kinds of entities. Based on the second criteria, the level of allowed interaction, we have three different categories of honeypots: low interaction, medium interaction, high interaction. So low interaction honeypots generally offer no interaction between the server and the attacker, and it's only just some software that it's emulating one or more services. They add low risk to the network, but generally the data capturing capabilities are not great. Then we have the medium interaction honeypots that offer greater interaction between the system and the attacker, and medium interaction honeypots can generally emulate different network services. And these, as I said before, they emulate the real service behavior, so they can output text or messages to the attacker, or even allow the attacker to enter, for example, a limited cell that responds to commands exactly like the real service could be. And they can also be used to catch malware also, apart from human attackers, by emulating specific vulnerabilities in a service or a protocol. Generally, a medium interaction honeypot is a good start if you want to get in the field, because they generally add a medium risk to the network, but they have very good results and data. Lastly, we have the high interaction honeypots, which are basically real systems that have real operating systems with security holes of our choice that are basically given to attackers as sacrificial lambs, so to speak. So an intruder that successfully hacks the system will have real access and real control of the system. And these systems are usually used to capture attacks against specific services, or if we want to create systems that fit a specific profile of a target, so we can catch attacks from adversary that target a specific industry, let's say, or a specific organization or something like that. Of course, they add the highest risk to the network, but they also have the highest reward to us. They provide the greatest level of the data capture, but the problem is that they must be isolated and monitored at all times, because, as I said, if an attacker gets inside them and gets control of the system, he can use the system to attack other systems inside your network or outside your network, which is even worse. So, in terms of where to place a honeypot and how to operate them, we generally have three different placement spots. External placement, which is in front of our firewalls and facing the internet directly. Internal placement, behind the firewall, and in our DMZ zones. The external placement option is being used to make the honeypots immediately available to attackers for intrusion takeover, and it's the most suitable option for research honeypots. Internal placement is most suitable to detect attackers, either human or malware, that have breached the perimeter of our networks and are inside. This is another option if we want to catch insider threats, for example. and this can add be an effective early warning system, and we add the high risk to the network, of course, if we are using a high interaction honeypot, as I said before. So we need to be very careful and use an egress firewall around those honeypots if they are high interaction. And lastly, we have the DMZ placement, which is the best choice for a business or organization. Honeypots that are placed in the DMZ zone share the same subnet as the other systems in our DMZ zone and can be set up as mirrors, as I said, of our real systems in order to catch attacks that are targeting our real servers and also make attackers waste their time and effort on those. Some other honeypot technologies that are worth mentioning, and this could be quite old, but they have modern usages. So we have honey tokens, which are objects with no production value whatsoever that are placed inside the system to act as an intrusion detection mechanism. This could be, for example, some fake administrator credentials in database. If we monitor closely our application logs and we see these fake credentials being used in any part of our site, for example, we can be sure that our database has been leaked. Another technology is that of the honey pages, which are basically fake web pages inside the real web app that have no production value. There are no direct links to those pages from the real pages of our site, and every request that comes to those can be considered malicious. A request can come from either automated scanning, if somebody runs a web app scan against our service, by somebody that analyzes the robot.txt file to find secret, let's say, folders in our app. And honey pages log every info they can get, so we can have an understanding of who and why would like to scan our application. Lastly, we have what we call client honeypots or honey clients, which are basically software that instead of waiting for attacks like a traditional honeypot, actively tries to find servers and websites that are serving exploits against client programs, like for example media players or a PDF viewer inside the browser. And these programs are basically emulating a web browser, so they use HTTP and they emulate various technologies of web browsers like JavaScript and ActiveX. If you want to give a honey client a try, a good one, it's called Thug. It's written in Python, and because its installation is somewhat difficult, you can Google online for a project I have created called Thug Vagrant, which is basically a Vagrant box, a Vagrant file configuration to create a virtual box with Thug pre-installed. By the way, I should have mentioned that I have various links on my slides, so if you want to try any of the tools, you better take some notes of them. Continuing with the value of honeypots and why we should use them, the first thing that is very important is that they give almost no false positive, which is the big problem with IDS systems. Since they have no production value whatsoever, any interaction can be automatically considered malicious and a candidate for further analysis. Secondly, they can help us detect malicious actions early on, because as I said, they can act as an early warning system. So system administrators can use them to quickly classify if an attack is serious or not. Furthermore, if there is a new and unknown attack, we can catch it instead of waiting for a signature for an IDS system, for example. And even more, if we have a honeypot and we use some tools like Honeycomb, for example, we can create IDS rules ourselves by using, for example, a captured a pickup file of an attack. Also, all the files and content that are generated by attackers, this could be either hacking tools or another common thing is for hackers to place IRC servers inside the captured systems and communicate through them. You can catch all of those and you can analyze and see who is attacking you and what's the reason behind it. Lastly, they add an extra layer of protection, and if you place them, for example, internally, you can catch, as I said, insider threats, or you can see if a malware has penetrated your perimeter. Some other advantages of honeypots are the simplicity of their idea. They don't, they are not very innovative, let's say, as an idea. Honeypots have started to be around in the 80s even. And they provide a small amount of captured data of high value, so you can be focused on what you analyze without wasting time. They have very low requirements in terms of hardware, I mean very, very low, and can be effective in environments where cryptography is used, where, for example, IT systems might have problem because they cannot decrypt the traffic, and they can be effective again in IPv6 networks. Of course, as any tool, honeypots are not without disadvantages, so the biggest disadvantage of them is that they have no real value if nobody attacks them. And another thing is that they have limited attack detection scope. They can only catch attacks that are directed against them and not other systems that they are in the same subnet, for example. One thing that I mentioned a lot of times so far is that we need to be very careful if we are using high interaction honeypots, because a compromised high interaction honeypot can be used as a platform to launch further attacks, and we don't want that. Some people can argue that honeypots can taunt attackers, so to speak, because if a honeypot is identified by an attacker, let's say that he might be angered and try to attack any other system that he can find in the same subnet. Since honeypots are software also, they can have bugs or vulnerabilities themselves. And from a security standpoint, placing extra systems in a network could be, let's say, bad, so to speak, because it increases the overall complexity. Furthermore, there are some legal issues concerning the usage of honeypots that I want to discuss. I should start with a big disclaimer that I'm not a lawyer and that you should always consult an expert about these things. But if the usage of honeypots has it's a challenge, because there are different legislations around the world and different laws that govern data acquisition and storage. So there is no definite 100% answer that can be given if a honeypot operation is totally legal or no, but all the top researchers in the field agree that we are on the safe side if we are using those. And there are specifically three different legal issues around honeypots. The first one is privacy, which can be summarized by a question. How much data can an administrator gather and store before a privacy problem arises? And furthermore, is it legal for an administrator from your company to capture data from other companies? And what about external threats in general? And according to Lance Pitzner, who is a well-known researcher in the field of honeypots, and by studying the US legislation around data acquisitions and forensic investigations, he concluded that the people breaking into the systems, the honeypots, are not authorized to use them, so if they place any files on them, they essentially have given up their privacy rights to those files. And also, if they use honeypots for communication between them, the malicious actors have given up again their right to privacy, as honeypots and we operate them, we are not service providers, and we are not bound by privacy requirements that are designed for service providers specifically. The second legal issue is entrapment, which means that somebody is induced or persuaded by law enforcement officers or agents to commit a crime that he had no previous intent to commit. Again, setting up a honeypot cannot be considered an entrapment activity, because honeypots by themselves do not induce or persuade anybody, neither they promote any activity by themselves, since attackers always find them and attack them on their own initiative. And furthermore, administrators of a company are not working for a law enforcement agency, and they are mostly gathering activities in order to enhance their own knowledge about how attackers operate. And lastly, we have liability, which is the most tricky one of the issues, and it can be summarized by a hypothetical scenario. Let's say that company X runs a honeypot, and this is a high interaction honeypot, so a real system that an attacker can take over entirely. And let's say that this happens, and then the attacker uses this machine as a source for attacks against another company. So in that situation, who is to blame? The original attacker, administrators of company X, or who else? So there is no definite answer in this case, but as I said many times, if we use a high interaction honeypot, we should have mitigated the risk that we have added to our network in the first place by using firewalls, egress filtering, monitoring at all times. Now let's go into the more practical, let's say, part of the presentation, which is the threat intelligence gathering part. So the Harnet project, which I said is a non-profit organization that I'm also a member of, in cooperation with a German university, published the first of those public live maps of attacks that you can find online these days. It's available in the address that you see on your slide, and it basically shows a live map of attacks coming against various honeypot sensors that have been deployed around the world. So there are many different tools and scripts that we can use in order to gather our own intelligence. And in this table, I have summarized some of the well-known honeypot software and also what type of attacks they catch, which operating systems they support, what language they are in, if they have a GUI or not, and what license they use. So you can see that most of the honeypots are of generic type, which means that they can catch various types of attacks, but of course you also have specialized honeypots. If you see in the bottom, for example, we have specific voice over IP honeypot and a specific USB honeypot. Usually they are written in C or Python, they are console based, and are probably like 9 out of 10 times open sourced. And I will talk about some specific tools. So let me start by the HoneyDrive, which is mentioned in the description of the webinar. It is the tool that I have created. It's now in its third version, and it's basically a self-contained honeypot Linux distribution. You can download it from the URL that you see on your slide, and it's distributed as an OVA file, which is, let's say, the newest version of OVF, the Open Virtualization Format, which means that you can just double-click on it, and it will be imported in a virtual machine hypervisor like VirtualBox. It contains more than 10 honeypot systems that are already pre-installed and pre-configured with other scripts on top of them to work out of the box, plus around 90 other tools that can help you in the analysis phase, the detection phase, and forensics, and that kind of stuff. And I created the HoneyDrive mostly because some of the well-known honeypot systems can be difficult to install and configure properly, so I wanted to have a straightforward medium to quickly test and deploy different honeypot systems, and also make it easy for other people to do so also. So let's go into some specific tools that can catch specific types of attacks. For SSH attacks, for example, we have Kipo, which is a medium interaction honeypot written in Python. As I said, medium interaction honeypots means that they allow some interaction with the attacker, and Kipo specifically can open a shell session, which is fake of course, with an attacker, and can log everything that an attacker types in this session, and can save those files as UML compatible. UML meaning user mode Linux compatible, so you can use a tool like TCP replay, for example, to replay those sessions like in real time. It can also store all of the files that attackers download in the system, so this is good if you want to gather some of the hacking tools that these people are using. By default, it emulates Debian operating systems system, but you can add your own files and content, and also if some commands are not implemented, you can add your own output to those. So you can create a customized file system based on your own needs and If you want, for example, to emulate a specific type of system, like an FTP server, it could be easy to use Kipo to do so. A tool that I have created that can be used for Kipo is called Kipo Graph. You can download it from the URL that it's on the slide, and it looks like something like the images on the bottom. It creates many charts and graphs from your Kipo Honeypot instance. It can geolocate attackers, it can list all of the files that you have downloaded, and you can submit those files to antivirus scanning engines, and you can also replay all of the captured sessions inside the web interface, and many other kind of cool things. And Kipo Graph is also included inside Honeydrive, and as I said, all of those tools are pre-configured to work together. So if you download Honeydrive and you run Kipo, Kipo Graph is automatically configured to get all of the data and display them for you. Another tool that I use lately is the ELK stack, or elsewhere, you know, which is short for Elasticsearch, Logstash and Kibana, which is Elasticsearch is basically a platform where you can store text and then use free text search on it. And I have created my own fork of Kipo, which you can find again in that specific URL that you see on the slides, that has Elasticsearch support. This means that you can add your own Elasticsearch instance or Elasticsearch cluster in the configuration file of Kipo, and then have Kipo index JSON logs of every attack that it captures. And you can then use Kibana to see a nice visualization of attacks that are coming against your sensor, and this looks like the images on the bottom. And of course you can use many different Kipo sensors in many different parts of the world, and they can all write to the same Elasticsearch instance. By the way, I should mention here that Elasticsearch is not, let's say, the securest of platforms, but recently the Elasticsearch people announced that they basically create a security plugin, so to speak, that will be commercially available. For malware attacks specifically, the best honeypot to use is called Dionea. And it's a successor of an older honeypot that you might have heard of, that was called Nepenthes. Dionea is written in C, and it has a layer on top written in Python, and it emulates protocols, which is a difference between other kind of malware honeypots, which mostly emulate specific vulnerabilities. But Dionea, by emulating protocol themselves instead of specific vulnerabilities, it can catch future exploits and attacks against specific protocols. The main protocol that Dionea uses in order to catch malware is SMB, otherwise known as CIFS, and it's the main protocol that malware uses in order to go from one system to another. But as you can see, it can also catch attacks against many other protocols like HTTP and HTTPS, TFTP and plain FTP, Microsoft SQL Server and MySQL Server, and also some voice over IP attacks. Dionea uses another piece of software called libbmu, which is a library that can analyze shell code, and you can do that by having the shell code run inside a specific libbmu virtual machine, and then it records all of the API calls that the malware does in order to identify what kind of malware it is. And for Dionea specifically, another visualization tool that you can use in order to better understand your captured data, it's called Dionea FR. It's a front end for Dionea, and you can get it from the URL that you see in the slides. This is written in Python, and it's it looks like the images on the bottom. So you can have pies and time graphs of your attacks, and again, geolocation information about where your attacks are coming from. And by the way, I should stress here that this doesn't necessarily mean that the attackers are from those countries. It could be generally mean that infected systems are in those countries that have some worms on them that try to automatically propagate to other machines. Moving on to web application attacks, we have Glasstop, which is a web application honeypot that can emulate thousands of vulnerability types in order to catch web attacks. These types here that is mentioned here, this basically it means something like Dionea emulating protocols instead of specific vulnerabilities. So Glasstop also emulates types of vulnerabilities instead of specific things, so it can also catch new attacks and attacks that are not fitting in a specified format, and can download from glasstop.org. And another honeypot for web attacks, it's called WordPot, and it's a honeypot that emulates a WordPress installation that many companies use, for example, for their blogs. And you can catch attacks against the specific WordPress plugins and specific WordPress themes that have various types of web vulnerabilities. Moving on, we have Compot, which is a very interesting honeypot, since lately we'll be seeing a lot of press around SCADA and ICS vulnerabilities and how they can affect a whole nation and the national infrastructure of developed nations. So Compot is an ICS honeypot. It collects intelligence about the motives and methods of attackers who target industrial control systems. And it emulates the Modbus protocol, which is the most widely used protocol for SCADA devices to communicate with each other, for example, RTUs and PLCs. And you can also add your own device if you have some coding skills, of course. And also you can add your own HMIs, which is the human-machine interface, which is the pretty screen, let's say, that an operator of a SCADA architecture would see on his computer and where he would operate the whole system. Moving on, for network simulation, we have HoneyD, which is probably the oldest of honeypots, which can create virtual hosts inside the network. And these hosts can be either machines themselves, or using HoneyD, you can even emulate specific network devices, like routers, switches, and so on. So you can emulate entire network and system topologies instead of only specific services and one specific machine. And they have also created two specific tools about this. The first one is HoneyD to MySQL, which is a simple script that can transfer the HoneyD text-based log file to a MySQL database. And then you can use a tool that is similar to Kippograph. It's called HoneyDVs, and it's a visualization tool for HoneyD, and it can also create charts and visualization about what your honeypot has captured so far. In terms of active defense, there is a distro that you can use. It's called ADHD, and this is somewhat different from HoneyDrive, because HoneyDrive contains mostly honeypots, and if you want to have interaction with attackers, and if I could say so, the more activity you can capture, the better. But ADHD contains mostly active defense tools that will probably cut off attackers from the early stages. But if you want this, it's a good option for you to use. So it contains tools like Artillery and Bear Trap for blacklisting IP addresses of attackers. These tools, for example, can work like that. I will talk about Artillery that I have used in the past. Artillery can listen for connection in any unused port of a system and immediately add an IP tables rule to drop any connections that are coming to unused ports, which will probably be a product of a network scan or a web application, a vulnerability scanner or something. Other tools that this distribution include are Decloak and the Honeybadger to unmask attackers and try to find their real IP address, for example, if they are behind proxies. And also SpiderTrap and Web Labyrinth that can trap malicious web scanners in endless loop by creating fake websites that are linking to each other all the time. So they can, those malicious web scanners or crawlers can never go out of your website. A system that's quite interesting, and it has been recently released, it's now in a beta version. It's by some researchers from the HarnetNet project, the non-profit organization that I mentioned before. It's called BSwarm, and it's an active IDS system. So this provides an easy configuration, deployment and management of honeypots and different clients. And it's it has an interesting architecture because instead of just creating a honeypot system and waiting for attacks, it also creates what the system calls drones, which are basically some fake clients that interact with the honeypot server. So you can imagine it like the honeypot itself, let's say, being a fake FTP server, and then those drones being clients that exchange files with this FTP server, and also, of course, sending supposedly real plain text credentials. So using this architecture, you can basically use honey tokens, as I told before, which is objects that have no production value that you can use as detection mechanisms. And using this kind of system, you can see that an attacker, which is displayed by the red shape there, can also attack the drones itself and intercept their activity instead of just attacking the honeypot server, let's say. And both the honeypot and all of the drones report back to a BSwarm server where you can have statistics about the attacks that are coming against you. Lastly, some other tools that are worth to be mentioned, but I haven't tried them extensively. It's the first one, it's the Modern Honey Network, which is a solution for managing and deploying common honeypot sensors, and then having centralized location where we can operate them and see what's going on. Another tool created by a friend of mine, it's called the Combine, which is a script that gathers threat intelligence from various public feeds. And lastly, we have Arc Reactor, which is again a system that can monitor public sources for open source intelligence information and public feeds, and then can send those information back to an SIEM system. By the way, Arc Reactor, I think it's not very functional in its current implementation, but the developer is actively working on it. And finalizing with some conclusions, you could see that honeypots present a unique concept, even though it's an old concept, but it's still very interesting and unique. And I could say that they are more useful than ever. With the current landscape of global attacks that is going on, especially specific types of honeypots could be very important for researchers and companies to set up to catch threat intelligence. There are many good tools and utilities that you can easily use to deploy sensors and gather intelligence, and furthermore, intelligence that matters to you specifically and not general attacks. And there's much activity in the field, either by organizations like the HarnetNet project or by individual researchers. So I would urge all of you to give them a try. And if you need any help or if you want to collaborate with anything, you can contact me through those means. Bruteforce.gr is my personal website, and my email and my Twitter handle are also on the slide. And thank you. I should give it back to Ken, I think, for Q&A.
Sure, thank you. You know, one example, too, that I wanted to cover was just something I was experimenting with myself, sort of similar to Combine and some of the things that Arc Reactor is doing is, you know, I was looking at some honeypots. Here's an example, something I pulled out of Kippo in one of the honeypots that I'm running. I had this IP address, and you know, I ran this through another one of my favorite tools called Collective Intelligence Framework. If anyone's worked with that, it's pretty slick. It actually integrates with a lot of different threat intelligence feeds, both open source and commercial. So I run that through, and I'm able to get some information around this. And as you can see, that there's a confidence level of around 95. So before I do any sort of automation around, you know, blocking an IP address, usually I want to get, you know, two pieces of evidence before I convict. So, you know, I see that he's been doing some malicious things on my server through my honeypot. You know, he's got 56 different sessions. I ran a search through my collective intelligence framework, and this is something that I can also automate through the API. A nice thing about the collective intelligence framework as well is that you can actually choose what format you want that to come out as, and you can include snort rules or rules for Suricata or Bro IDS or other systems. So I thought it was kind of a slick way to sort of, you know, verify that this IP, yes, it is bad. Another nice thing about this is that you can also collect those logs and you can forward them on to a log intelligence tool like Tripwire Log Center. You can then customize and create correlation rules where you can trigger alerts. You can forward that on to another SIM, be it ArcSight or other tools that you may have within your organization, and the, you know, at least automate processes and scripts and things like that to, you know, update your IDS or other systems. And so with that, we're going to go ahead and we're going to open it up for a Q&A. Let me check some questions here. We got quite a few. So first one, Giannis, is for you. Will deploying honeypots expose out the attack surface of my organization?
It depends. Well, if you set up honeypots as 100% accurate mirrors of your own servers, which is an option, of course, but yeah, you should keep in mind that this could expose the attack surface of your organization. But in any case, if you have servers in your own DMZ, you are already exposing, you know, your attack surface. So I would say that the best option is perhaps to set up specific honeypots in order to catch specific attacks against services that you want to monitor.
Great. Another one is for you. I'm an ISC student who is doing research on honeypots. What's the best place for students to start?
Yeah, the best place is to contact the HoneyNet project, the nonprofit organization. You can actually send an email to me afterwards if you want, and I can get you in touch with them. We have many academics in the organization that can even help you with finding a thesis subject, for example, or do some research work around honeypots.
Great. So here's a, this will, I think this will be an interesting conversation. You know, the legal question comes up quite often around honeypots, and someone wants to know, is it legal to counter attack a hacker from a business? You know, I think there's, you know, one thing about passive collection of data, you know, doing things within your own environment or blocking a connection, but, you know, actively going after and, you know, initiating scans or trying to fire exploits against an attacker. Do you have any experience with that? You know, I know we know you're not an attorney, but in your experience, have you seen other folks that are doing this type of thing?
Well, I have seen some tools that, for example, for Kipo specifically, I have seen a fork that uses the dictionary that the dictionary of usernames and passwords that attackers use against Kipo for the same system to launch attacks back. But you know, the idea behind it is that systems that run, for example, SSH attacks, automated those SSH attacks, are already compromised. So I'm generally against the idea of hacking back. Because you never know to which system you will end up. As I said during the presentation, you might have a situation where a honeypot even from one company is being used to launch attacks against another company. Of course, it doesn't make any sense for you to hack back. You will have a very strange legal situation if you do that.
That's interesting. And then I guess, you know, something that's sort of timely. You know, I've seen some honeypots that are out there that are for Heartbleed, for example. And now with the new, you know, bash bug, which I think all of us have been busy with right now, you know, do you have any ideas for, you know, honeypots for specific exploits like that?
Yes, I wouldn't call them, you know, honeypots per se, but I know of two specific scripts, for example, that can listen for specific attacks against SSL and Heartbleed specifically. I have even set up some of those. One interesting finding was that a university, I don't remember which one now, it's the same people that have created the ZMAP scanner, the ZMAP scanner. They have scanned my server because they're doing some research on, you know, the amount of servers that are still out there and they are still non-patched for Heartbleed.
That's great, great. Well, I think that's all of our questions. I think we're out of time here. So, you know, thank you again. I really appreciate it. I think this was a great webcast, very informative. And also, I think it's a lot of fun. So we
okay,
are going to provide the slides.
I can see some of the other questions
okay.
on my own. Ah, Ken, you're back?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Ah, okay. Sorry, I thought we lost you. Should we continue with more questions?
I think what we'll do is we'll go through, we can ask another couple more questions. Let's see, did you want to answer a question specifically I noticed that you saw?
Let's see, somebody says that many of the tools that are listed are not under active development, or at least they don't have updates, very recent updates. Yeah, this is true for some of the tools, but I could say that all of the developers are active in the field in general, even though they are not updating the tools, but they are maintaining them. And as you can see, new tools are constantly being created, like the Modern Harry Network or the BSwarm project. Compot also, it has also get, it did get some publicity, by the way. Glasstop has had three iterations. It was even have been rewritten from scratch. So I would say that there is some activity. The bad thing, in quotes, so to speak, it's that most of the researchers are involved in honeypots as a side project. They're not their, you know, their real day-to-day job. So they can only advance their software during their own free time. And another thing that perhaps should be discussed at some point if is if any companies would like to sponsor, for example, any of these efforts.
Did you see any other questions there that you'd like to answer? We'll go through these two, and we'll maybe we'll have a blog post, and we'll try to answer some additional questions there. Again, we're going to make these slides available up on the website. There'll also be an archive of this webcast, and we'll also try to go through and identify some of these tools as well and link to those. And I think that's it. Back to you, Kate.
Thanks a lot, Ken. Yes, thank you to Ioannis Konyaris today. We really appreciate you being here for us. And thank you to you, Ken, for presenting as well. Thanks for listening in, our audience, and for all your great questions. As Ken just mentioned, I'll be sending out a link to the on-demand webcast and the slides. We do hope you join us for future webcasts. You can check out tripwire.com for that, and also check out our blog, The State of Security, for interesting and timely posts. I want to thank you, and have a great day today.